Well, welcome. How's everybody this evening? Everybody okay? At least you're at least halfway decent because you were able to come to Bible study tonight. So glad you're here. Let me pray for us and we'll get started. Father God, we thank you for our night and we thank you for the time and the place that you allow us to come and to open up your word and to look at it and have you speak your truth into our lives through it. Father, we ask that you would help us to hear what it is that you want us to hear tonight. Father, may you give us the type of spirit that is receptive to your spirit as you teach us and as you comfort us and as you remind us of things that we already know. Father, I thank you for each person that's here, and I thank you for their families and everything that's represented, and ask a special blessing on them tonight, and help us to be true to your truth and to what it is that you would have us for this evening. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, so we've been talking about heaven for the past few weeks, and we spent the first few weeks looking at just kind of the overall big idea of it and looking at what Scripture has to say about it and what Scripture doesn't have to say about it. And we talked about how there was a lot of it's a lot of wiggle room in there, and there's a lot of holes and a lot of stuff that we've got to kind of piece together and put together, and so we've been doing that for a few weeks, and we kind of just kind of nailed down this whole idea that there is a heaven, obviously, that we believe in, and that God's prepared that place for us, and that it is a place that we go to. And we spent some time talking about what our bodies would be like, what our resurrected bodies would be like, some of the different associations and things that would be in heaven. We looked at some of the big promises, the kind of the duh statements, that in heaven God is supreme, that Jesus is supreme, that it is for eternity, that it is a wonderful place and way more than wonderful than we can ever imagine that a place would be, that it's for a global community. So it is not just all of one kind of a group of people or from one nation or anything like that. And that all of our relationships are in heaven will be the best that they have ever been. I mean, we just can't even comprehend what it's going to be like to have no conflict and no turmoil, none of that kind of stuff present in heaven. And so what we've done the past couple of weeks is we're looking at this chapter, Matthew chapter 13 specifically. And the reason that we're looking at Matthew chapter 13 is because we have these set of parables taught by Jesus. And each one of these parables starts off like this. The kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is like. Now we talked about, let's see if somebody was here and you remember, what's the difference between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God? It's the same, right, okay. And the kingdom of heaven, primarily used by Matthew in the book of Matthew, Matthew is writing to who? Jews, okay. It's really important when you study a book of the Bible, you know who's the writer, who's he writing to, what's his purpose, what's his intent. So Matthew is writing to Jews. So Jews don't say God, they don't say the name, they had reverence for that. So Matthew tend to call it the kingdom of heaven. Now we get into John and Mark and Luke, they tend to call it the kingdom of God. Kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God is the same thing. And so last week we looked at a couple of these parables that kingdom of heaven is like. And one of the things that we talked about last week is that heaven, the kingdom of heaven is, for lack of a better way of saying it, there and future. And when we think about heaven, this is usually what we think about. We think about heaven as somewhere that I'm going to go, and it's in the future. Okay? Now, when we look at the teachings of Jesus, and when Jesus talks about heaven, he talks about the kingdom of heaven, a lot of times what he's talking about is he's referring to it as the here and now. That the kingdom of heaven is now, and that it's not just there and in the future, but it's also the here and the now. And we get that from the when the disciples ask Jesus, teach us how to pray, and he gives the Lord's Prayer, or praying that the God's will that is done in heaven perfectly would also be done on earth, and that we are to be carrying out all of the aspects of what heaven are the here and the now, as we are getting ready and as we're preparing for and as we're looking for and as we're hoping for and as we're holding on to the there and in the future. So this here and now, so he has all of these statements where the kingdom of heaven is like. Which is interesting, isn't it? That he doesn't say the kingdom of heaven is. The kingdom of heaven is like. So it seems as if Jesus is painting pictures for us. He's not telling us details. He's given us stories. He's telling us parables. Some he explains, actually very few that he explains. Most he does not explain. Sometimes they're confusing. Sometimes they're very simple. So what we have in Matthew 13 is we got this parable after parable after parable after parable of Jesus talking about the kingdom of heaven is like. Starts off with the famous parable that almost all of us know about the farmer who goes out and throws the seeds. And some seeds land on the path and the birds come and take them away. And some seeds land and they grow, but the sun comes and scorches them out really quick. We're familiar with that in the desert. You'll see something pop up after rain, and then a couple weeks later it's dried and gone away. Some fell in ground, grew, and then was choked out by the weeds and briars. And then some fell in the good soil and produced 100-fold, 50-fold, 30-fold, 20-fold, 10-fold, or however that says that. And point being, because they didn't understand what he was saying, he explained it, and that the farmer is God, and the seed is the word of God, is the gospel, and as it goes out there, when it lands on the hard stuff and the birds take it away, that's Satan who comes in and takes the truth away from people. The ones that don't have enough roots, they might believe for a second, or they might go, oh, okay, this sounds really great, I think I'm in it, but they don't get grounded, so that doesn't last. And then the other group that allows the cares and the worries and the whatever of this world to choke them out. And then the good part being obviously the good part. That is followed with the parable that we looked at last week, which is called the parable of the wheat and the tares. And where it says, again, he's given this example, telling the story. Farmer goes out, throws seed out, and the wheat grows up. And it's great. But then in the night, an enemy comes in and plants weeds. And then the weeds come up. And then the workers go to the farmer and say, what do? We got weeds. You want us to pull up the weeds? And he says, no, leave it like it is, because at the end, everything will be harvested, and the angels will separate the good and the bad, and the good will be rewarded, and the bad will be bound and burned up. So these first two parables that we have in Matthew chapter 13, we've got some things that are pretty significant that we have to understand here. Not everybody gets it. Not everybody accepts the gospel. There is a such thing as weeds. There is such thing as wheat. There is a such thing as heaven. There is such thing as a hell. There is a judgment of the good. There is a judgment of the evil. And so we have these two parables telling this, which as he's teaching and as he's teaching his disciples, this is not the best news in the world, right? When we hear things like not everybody's going to be in heaven, This doesn't sit well with us. We don't like this. We don't like that. Doesn't sit well in our soul at all. Especially when we start thinking about family members and friends and all of this kind of stuff. And we got all kind of questions that we will, in a few weeks, start specifically answering after we get through with these parables. So we have these two parables, which leads us to the two parables that we're going to talk about tonight. And they're short parables. And so he's going to come in again and say the kingdom of heaven is like. So here's a question that I want to ask you. It's very important because Jesus talks about this way more than he talks about this. Okay? Now this is what? What am I saying by this? Somebody tell me. Make sure y'all are hearing me. Do what? Okay. But what is this?
It's heaven.
Heaven in the future. I'm just making you get some more words.
Future event.
Future event. Heaven as we think about it. The place I go when I die. This kind of stuff, right? Okay? And that's why so many of you are here on Wednesday night. This is the most people we've ever had for a Bible study. Okay? Because you want to know about this. Because this is intriguing. This is, what is this? What's going on with this? And we've done that, and we're going to do some more of that. But Jesus did talk about this, but very little. Okay? He talked about this a lot. Okay? He talked about the here and the now. How am I living Tuesday? How am I living Wednesday? How am I living in June? How am I living in September? How am I living in my 20s? How am I living in my 30s? How am I living in my, you know, for some of y'all, your hundreds. You know, how am I? So Jesus spends an awful lot of time talking about the here and now. Why is that so important? Why is it so important for us to understand? Yeah, we got to have an understanding of this, but we also need to really understand this. Why is this so important? If we don't understand that, we may not get this.
Right.
Okay, anybody want to add anything to that? I kind of summed it up. Right? That's why this is so important, because if we don't get this right, this doesn't happen. Okay? The thing that's very clear in Scripture is that we are judged for our behavior. We're judged for how we live. Now, we've talked about it for the last couple of weeks. I'm not saying you earn your salvation. I'm not saying that. Okay? But once you are saved, your life must be different. It has to be. Because you are called to holiness. You cannot be, okay, I'm taking what Jesus is selling, and I'm going to put it in my back pocket, and I'm going to hold on to that fire insurance card until I die. And it's not the way that it works. And we... Yes, is God our Savior or is He our Lord? Now, what we want Him to be is our Lord and Savior. Okay, and He can't be our Lord until He's our Savior. But what a lot of people want to do, and what is taught in a lot of churches, is just the Savior part. Just the Savior part is what is taught. And the Lord part, the Lordship part, is not taught. And those two things go together. You cannot find in Scripture where Jesus is just Savior. He is always Lord and Savior, or just Lord. Okay? And so that part of it is incredibly important, because the here and now is important. So let's read this. We're going to read this, the parable of the mustard seed. It is in Matthew 13. We're going to look at verses 31 and 32. So here we go. Let's talk about a mustard seed first. Anybody ever seen a mustard seed? Got a few of you saying, how small is it? It is teeny tiny. It is teeny tiny. It is not, I mean, it is like, oh, you got some mustard seed? All right, there is one mustard seed in this bag. It's right there. It looks about like a grain of sand. Okay, so I'm going to just pass this around. You can see how, well, you can almost see. For those of you in your hundreds, you might not be able to see. So it is small. It is small. All right. So it is also known to produce a little bit of a hot flavor to it. So it's got a little kick to it. It's the smallest seed, but when it would be planted and it would grow, it could grow up to heights of 10 to 15 feet. So you have something. Now remember, Jesus is talking to people who live in a land very much like we are in right now, except take the irrigation away, okay? So it's not quite as green. So this idea that you could have any plant that would grow to be 10 or 15 feet, this is a significant plant that would happen. So it started out as the smallest, ended up as one, if not the biggest, and in the fall, it's interesting that the branches, I guess based on the hot, dry summer or whatever, the branches would stiffen up to the point that birds can nest in them. And so birds found shelter and support in this mustard plant. So when Jesus is talking about this stuff and he tells this story, they may not understand what he's talking about, but everybody knows what a mustard seed is and everybody knows what a mustard plant is. Now, we don't do that. We don't know that, but they would know that kind of stuff almost instantly. Also, in the time, at this particular time, there was kind of a proverbial use or a slang use of a mustard seed. And it would be kind of like how we would say the runt in the litter. You know, we have that. We would say that about dogs, or even sometimes we say that about, you know, kids. And it's like, well, this one was the runt in the litter, you know, because he's smaller than everybody else or whatever. And so a lot of times people would say, they would say stuff about the mustard seed, and they would use it in that context of saying it's so small, and it's so small it seems insignificant, okay? So this is what is going on in Matthew chapter 17, verse 20. Jesus uses a mustard seed another time, and he says, if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you will be able to move mountains. And he's talking about, so if we can just have a little bit of faith, there's all kinds of things that can happen if we will have that, and that part is very important, okay? All right, so let's read it. Let's see what it says. Matthew 13, verses 31. Here's another illustration Jesus used. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed planted in a field. It's the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of garden plants. It grows into a tree, and birds come and make nests in its branches. Now, there's no explanation here. It just says it, and that's it. I mean, how would you like for that to be Sunday morning? You come to church on Sunday morning, you got everything that goes through. You know, somebody like me stands up and gives like a two-sentence story that doesn't really make much sense and says, see you next week. And so that's basically what's going on here. So what possibly is Jesus mean by this when he said that the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed? So here we'll go through some things that we can kind of draw and think that it can mean. First one is this. The kingdom of heaven would have a very small beginning. So the kingdom of heaven would have a small beginning. In Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1, he says, out of the stump of David's family will grow a shoot. Yes, a new branch bearing fruit from the old root. Just talking about a stump. We got several other places. And another place in Isaiah 53 and in Daniel chapter 2, verse 35, there's references to the kingdom of God and what's going to happen in the future. And that it starts very, very small. It starts with a few people. So when God chooses to begin the nation of Israel, does he start with hundreds of thousands of people? Who does he start with? He starts with one man. He starts with Abraham. Okay? When Jesus begins to start his ministry, does he start with hundreds and thousands of people? No, he starts with what? He starts with 12 guys. And he says, this is how we are going to start. So the kingdom of heaven would have a small beginning. The second one is this. The kingdom of heaven would grow from its humble beginnings. So it would grow and spread out. In Acts chapter 2, not this Sunday, but the following Sunday, we're starting a series called Invade, and we're going to be doing a series on the Holy Spirit. So this Acts chapter 2 is going to be one of our key verses, but in Acts chapter 2, verse 41 and 42, it would help if I was not in Romans. Acts chapter 2, get to the right book. Acts chapter 2, verse 41 and 42, very familiar to a lot of us. It says, those who believe that after Peter preached his sermon, said, those who believe what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all. So when Jesus promises and says, hey, the Holy Spirit's coming, and I want you to go to, and they went into the upper room and hung out until the Holy Spirit showed up, we have about 120 people. Okay, again, in relation to bigness of everybody, 120 people is not a whole lot. But it grows, because in one day, it went from 120 people to 3,000 in one day. So you have it start small, but then it's going to grow. It's going to get back bigger. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. It's this really little seed, but ends up providing shelter for the birds. Okay, so this whole idea of God's kingdom and Christianity, the movement of Christianity, is going to start small, but it's going to grow, and it's going to get bigger. Obviously, today we have churches, Christian churches and Christians all over the world. I mean, not every people group has been reached yet, but every continent has, every place that is going on that. So, another thing that we see in this is that the kingdom of heaven now would be beneficial to the world. Okay? The kingdom of heaven is like. So this gets back to this. This is so important, okay? Because we want to hang out in this land. I have a theory why a lot of people like to hear about heaven and the end times. Versus this. Because this doesn't change. This doesn't force you to do anything different. You can spend years studying the prophecies in the book of Daniel, and they don't have anything to do with how you treat your neighbor. Doesn't have anything to do with your holiness. Doesn't have anything to do with how you're living your life on a daily, day-to-day basis. So Jesus is saying the kingdom of heaven is like this mustard seed, and it's going to start small. Is going to grow, and it's going to be beneficial to the world, because this little short parable ends with what? Birds nesting, birds resting, birds taking refuge in its branches, which is a pretty significant thing. And we have all kinds of scriptures, you know, in Matthew 11, where Jesus says, bring me your, take on my burden. My yoke is easy. Don't be troubled by those kinds of things. So what about the kingdom growth today? So we're trying to grow. Are we trying to grow heaven? Are we trying to grow heaven? Okay, what's the most, in heaven, the most significant thing in heaven will be? What's the most significant thing about heaven? God. Yes, thank you. God. The most significant. What is the second most significant thing about heaven?
Jesus. Apart from hell.
Apart from hell, Jesus. Okay. What's the third most important thing? The people who are there. Okay. The people that are there. Okay. This is key. The people who are there. So are we trying to grow heaven from that standpoint? Yes. Okay, now, are we trying to add walls or add space or square footage? No, we don't. That's beyond us. But do we have a responsibility? Have we been charged with getting more people into heaven? Yes. Okay, so we have been doing. This is what we've been charged to do. This is the Great Commission. To go wherever you go, as you're living your life, make disciples. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We get to Acts 1 and chapter 2. Jesus is telling them, get out of here. Don't y'all dare stay huddled up here in Jerusalem. Get out there. Go to every place that you can go. And because our job is to grow heaven. So it starts small, ends big. Just to run some math numbers. If we started with 20 Christians, if we took less than half of people in the room, okay, not even everybody in the room, if we just took half of us, and for the next 12 months, each one of us was able to help one person come to Jesus. One. 20 people spent the next 12 months, and as a result of that 12 months, you had one person come to Christ. In 1 year, you would have how many people? 40. Thank you. Good. That's right. Good. That's good. That's good from the financial planner guy. He's got the numbers. After 5 years, we'd have 640. After 10 years, we'd have a little over 20,000. After 15 years, we'd have a little over 655,000. At the end of 20 years, we'd have a little over 20 million. After 25 years, we'd have 1.3 billion. We would have a lot, okay? So, is it a mathematical possibility? Yes, it is a mathematical. Now, the first two parables tell us that's not going to happen, because not all the seed falls on the good soil. The parable of the wheat and tares tells us that there's going to be tares, there's going to be weeds, and there's going to be wheat. So this is not going to happen. But that doesn't mean that we're not supposed to try. We have the calling on us to try to get and take as many people to heaven as we can, which has everything to do with here and now and almost nothing to do with there in the future. Okay? So there is the mathematical possibility of it. There's also the spiritual possibility of it. We have the same truth. We have the same truth that Peter and Paul and James, our gospel is not any different than their gospel. We're preaching and teaching and should be living the same gospel. The big question becomes, do I have that kind of vision? Do I have that kind of burden? Do I care about other people's souls? I have people will come to me and say, Marty, we need to do more for missions. I'm sure we do. But you don't know your neighbor's name. But you want us to do something halfway around the world and you don't know your neighbor's name. What would happen if we tried to evangelize the streets we lived on? Before we thought about sending checks to places we'll never go. Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't do that. Don't hear me saying that. Okay? But I'm just saying it has to start where we live. It has to start with the places that we at. And so do we have that kind of vision, that kind of thought for it? So the question is like, what does it take to help grow heaven? Well, I've got to have a vision for it. I've got to have a passion for it. I've got to see, you know, I've got to decide. Do I care about this person? Do I care about these? And then how do I go about it? And the primary way I have to go about that is then I have to start asking a question like this. Well, am I willing to put the kingdom of God first in my life? Or is the kingdom of God something I do on weekends? Am I going to put the kingdom of God first in my life? Because the seed of the gospel only produces fruit if it's planted. And it can't be planted if it's not sown, using that whole analogy. And so there's obviously all kinds of ways that we can do that. And we making sure we're not getting so caught up in this and making sure that we understand the here and the now, we got to make sure that we're not the ones allowing Satan to snatch us away, or we're not trying to get choked out by what's going on in the world and the worries and the cares and all of those kinds, because we do have this gospel. Now, at the heart, I think one of the things that's at the heart of this parable is encouragement. That the kingdom of heaven is designed for great things, even though it starts small. Okay? The kingdom of heaven is designed for great things, even though it starts small. Which is true. That's the way life works, right? Isn't that the way your life works? Most people don't start out making the most money they'll ever make in their career the first week of their job, of their first job. That's usually not the way it works, right? If it does work that way, their life usually spirals out of control very, very quickly. Okay? We all understand what it means to start small. So here's encouragement, because Jesus has just told two parables that said not everybody's getting in. He just told two parables that there's an enemy and he's evil and he's planting stuff and there's going to be people bound and cast into eternal torment. No, I mean, so this is not happy stuff. So he's coming back and saying, listen, even though it's small, even though it's just us, and because that's one of the things a lot of times, sometimes Jesus did teach in front of lots and lots of people, We know at one particular point in time he taught to 5,000 men, not counting their men, their families, because we know that he ended up feeding them. There's a lot of times Jesus is teaching to tens of people, not thousands and thousands of people. And when he's sitting around talking to the disciples and they're looking around, they're just counting. And some of them are going like, we're not sure about that Judas guy, right? So this is a small group of people. So he's encouraging them to say, hey, heaven is small, but it's going to accomplish great things. The reminder is, we're going to be useful in the ever-expanding kingdom, we must abide in him. Okay? So if I'm going to be useful in the here and the now, then I got to be walking with God. I've got to be pursuing that relationship. I've got to be allowing him to do those kinds of things in my life. If all I'm doing is sitting back here, it's that old phrase I grew up with, was some people are so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. Never heard that one? They can be so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. Now, the opposite of that is true too. We can be so earthly minded that we're no heavenly good, right? And we don't want that either. So we have to have this balance between the two. Of saying, yeah, heaven is for the future, but it's also for the here and the now. And I have to be abiding in him. And if I'm abiding in Christ and I'm working on that relationship with him, then the natural tendency of that is going to be to tell people. It's to share people. And you know what this is like. You know what this is like to get really, really good news. What do you do with it? You tell people. I mean, we count the number of shares on Facebook now. That's how people judge if something was good or not. How many likes did it get? How many views did it get? How many shares did it get? How many people saw this? Because you want people to know what it is. And the only way we're going to be good for here is if we're doing the right things here. And we've got to be reminded of that. And as we're reminded of that, knowing that the mustard seed is the mustard seed is super small, and so it gives us reassures us that even though it may not feel like we're doing the right thing, even though it may feel like we're not making the right kind of impact, that we actually are. So the mustard seed parable is followed by one that's very similar, and it is the parable of the yeast, or the parable of the leaven. So we're going to read that one real quick. Just real quick before we do that. I've never made bread in my life, but my wife used to make this unbelievable homemade bread. It was amazing. And she had a starter. You know what a starter is? She kept it in the refrigerator and she had to feed it. And it's like if you didn't feed it, it would die. And it had this yeast and it had this great smell to it. And I ended up killing the starter because took it out and forgot to put it back in the refrigerator. But anyway, don't bring that up to Lisa. But yeast, it takes when you make bread, maybe you don't know anything about making bread, but if you had to guess, do you think you put a whole lot of yeast in the flour? No. You put just a wee bit of yeast in the flour to make it do what it's doing. In fact, the yeast is fermented. It's growing, but it's dying all at the same time, and it's got that, yeah, it's that whole thing, yeah, it's got all that stuff breaking down and all that kind of stuff. So it's a yeast or a leaven is a small piece of fermented section of dough that you put in the flour or your other whatever you're making, and it goes. Now, in the scripture, if you're very familiar with scripture and you've read very much, when Jesus speaks of leaven or yeast, or especially when Paul would speak of leaven or yeast, did he speak of it positively or negatively? It's almost always negative. It's like this little, and it would be in the context of sin. You get a little sin. It's kind of like one bad apple spoils the whatever that saying is. And so it's almost always spoken of that way. So we have this one. So let's just read it. That's what it says. Jesus also used this illustration. the kingdom of heaven is like the yeast a woman used in making bread. Even though she put only a little yeast in 3 measures of flour, it permeated every part of the dough. The kingdom of heaven is like a yeast a woman used in making bread. Even though she put only a little yeast in 3 measures of flour, it permeated every part of the dough. So in this particular place, is Jesus talking about yeast in a bad way or a negative way? I mean, in a bad way, or in a positive way or a negative way? He's talking about it in a positive way. And some people get hung up on that, and there's just no reason to get hung up on that. First of all, just because they used it, he used it negatively in another one doesn't mean he can't use it in a positive one in here. And if he is saying that it's negative, then if the yeast in this is negative, then the kingdom of heaven is doomed. Okay, so we know this is not true, right? This is not what he's saying. So he's really following up the parable of the mustard seed with a parable that is almost identical, right? It's just, this is the same song, second verse, right? And here he's listening. So he's saying, here's what it's like. So the kingdom's growth will be pervasive, but this is a little bit different in that the little seed grows into something big. Here he's talking about a little something going in and being persuasive. It's working its way through. It's a little bit more of a manipulation, a little bit more of a sneaky feel, a little bit more of taking something that is already is and transforming it into the better. Okay? So it's very similar, but it's also very different. So this is the story this is the picture that he's painting. Now, also, it's also, I mean, if you've been around somebody who makes bread, you know what that's like. Sometimes you can go into Subway or a place like that that's making bread and you can smell it. This would have been so common because there was no store on the corner. If you wanted bread, you had to make it. So everybody would have known what this is about. So in this, the yeast, what do you think the yeast represents? It's always a good answer. No. Well, kind of. But, I mean, that's a great answer because it's kind of always there. The yeast is the kingdom of heaven. And the flour would be the world. That's right. So the yeast is representing the kingdom of heaven. So you could stretch it and say the Holy Spirit. Say God. It represents everything that he is. And then the flour represents the world. And so the growth so how does growth happen? How does this carry out? How does the kingdom of heaven get into the world and be invasive in it and be pervasive in it? How does that go about?
Mixed with our neighbors.
By believers. Okay, so going by the gospel. And remember, he's already taught a parable, and these are like boom, boom, boom. And he's saying, listen, there's a farmer out, and he's throwing the seed everywhere. And some of it's hitting in good spots, and some of it's hitting bad spots. And then there was the wheat and the tares. And then, hey, it's like a mustard seed. And everybody was like, oh, yeah, we love mustard seed. Da, 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 da. And then he's talking about bread. It's like, hey, who doesn't like bread, right? Everybody likes bread, and so we're going to talk about this. So growth happens in the form of the gospel. Just like I said earlier, we have the gospel. We have the same gospel that Peter preached. We have the same gospel that Jesus preached. We have this. Exactly. And not do anything. But put in the right circumstances with the right things, great things are produced. Has to be. That's a great point. Great point. So we have the form of the growth happens from the gospel. It happens from the church. I mean, we talk about this all the time, the local church. The local church is God's way to reach the world. And there is no plan B. Is it? There's no plan B. The local church is how we're going to reach the world. So the local church isn't doing it, it's not going to be done. People have done studies and have looked at the economy and people who proclaim to be Christians. If everybody who claims to be a Christian tithed, Christians could eradicate poverty in the entire world. Right now, we could do it. There would not be poverty anywhere if Christians did what God's called us to do. So this whole idea that we can change the world is there. It's possible. It's not possible if the yeast just sits on the counter. Then it's not. If the seed just sits in the package in the shed, it's not going to happen. We have to do our part.
You said that Matthew's speaking to the Jews, and that center one is a very Jewish concept, except that they're very xenophobic.
Very what?
Xenophobic.
What does that mean?
Well, it means they don't go outside of themselves.
Oh, okay.
They stay within themselves, and while they believe that your kingdom of heaven is here and now, I mean, they also have a heaven, but they believe in the here and now, and a very, very...
Closed here and the now.
Yeah,
so very closed,
really,
yeah.
Yeah. Their population stays relatively static.
Right. Which I would also argue happens among many Christians. Because when you get Christians, we huddle up. And we bunker in. And we make our own music and our own t-shirts and all that stuff. And we make our own schools, our own denominations, and if I don't like that denomination, I'll go start my own denomination.
Separation.
Separation.
Even though we're Christians, we're separated. That's what we're most
common. Yes, that's right, because we have taken on that. We haven't been the invasive thing that a yeast is supposed to be in a pile of flour. We've taken the yeast as Christians. We say, we've got the yeast, we've got the gospel, we've got the good news. We're going to go over here and sit on the counter and let y'all do whatever y'all want to do. Because I don't want to have anything to do with that. So that growth happens from the gospel. It happens from the church. It's both of those working together. Here's another interesting thing. When yeast is doing its thing, it's really not visible. You can smell it, but it's invisible. It's not. You don't really see it working. It's not. It's that. And so there's that element of this as well. Huh? You see the effects of it. You see the effects of it. It's like what Billy Graham said. You see the effects of the wind, but you can't see the wind. You see the effects of the wind. So we can certainly taste the effects of the yeast, and we can certainly see the effects, of the yeast. But actually seeing the yeast sometimes is a difficult thing. It's still that persuasive thing. Let's see. And this is a key thought too, because we talked about this other one of him here giving this, so we should be encouraged by the things that happen, that when yeast is put in the flour and it's done correctly, and it does what? It works. It produces bread. It gets the desired result. So the kingdom's influence, if we have the right the kingdom's influence and we're doing the right things, it will work. The influence will be complete. And that is, I think that's important for us to realize as well. So here's the application of this parable. So don't lose heart, because it is, it's really easy to lose heart, right? When you look around and you see what's going on, you look in your own life, you look in your own family, and I know some of you, you've tried and you've done everything that you can do. You've prayed and you've read and you've taught and you've begged and you've pleaded and you've put on magic shows. You've done whatever you can do to try to get people to hear and accept the gospel, and it just hasn't happened. The fear, yeah, there's a huge fear of rejection to even bring it up. And then a lot of times where we really get hit is when we might bring it up and we get rejected, then that really shuts us down. That is tough to do, because we fear that. So don't lose heart. I think that's part of what Jesus is saying here when he's using this example. That's right, right. But keep throwing the seed. You got to keep throwing the seed, because it's not up to us. It's up to us to throw the seed. It's not. It's that we can't lose that heart. And so the visible the visible standards are not always a good measurement. There's a lot of times stuff is going on that we don't know that's going on. I remember when we'd been going for 2 or 3 years and we'd have these, we're constantly, in fact, we had another one Tuesday. We had the big talk about, imagine that, music as it relates to church. And I remember John talking about, after we'd been going for a couple of years, and he would get kind of down on how many people were in church standing doing this. They're just standing there with their arms crossed. They may have been judging, but just standing there. And then he would tell me, he says, you know what, I ran into so-and-so at the Lowe's, and he told me he'd spent the last 2 months learning 3 of the worship songs that we've been doing the last 2 months on his guitar. And he's never done anything but this. He said, and then I ran into so-and-so, and they came up to me and said, they haven't said boo to me in 3 years. And they ran into me at the Home Depot, and all they talked about was how much they love the music. And John's just like, you know, it's just like, notify your face, please. You know, let me know something that's happening, that's going on here, right? And so this a lot of times happens. We're sowing the seed, We can't be discouraged. We got to keep doing it. We got to keep doing it, because a lot of times we don't know what is happening. We got to be confident that the mustard seed turns into the mustard plant, turns into the mustard tree, birds can take rescue in it, and that the yeast turns into some really, really good bread. And we got to keep doing that.
What happens to the flour if you don't put enough yeast in it, or if you put in too much yeast?
I don't know. We have any bread makers?
Not enough
it doesn't rise, and it's flat.
Too
much, it just goes everywhere, right? It just goes all over the oven, right? Right. Yeah, and I know not enough leaven or yeast, and we just use that bread for when we take communion.
But also, you can't put them back. Once they're out of the bottle, you can't put them back. You can't put the mustard plant back in the seed or the yeast back to an earth.
That's true. That's right. Once it's out there, it's out there. Yeah. So together, our kingdom work is not for nothing, and it's a lot of times it's just bigger than that. It's bigger than we think. I have this. It's just a great. I always go back to it. John Eldridge is one of the guys who just has really formed a lot of what I think and process and all that kind of stuff. And he says 3 things all the time. He's written tons of books, and every book is about the same 3 things. Things are not as they seem. We have an enemy, and we have a role to play. Things are not as they seem. We have an enemy, and I have a role to play. Things are not as they seem. I have an enemy, and I have a role to play. And man, I tell you, just about all of my life, I can narrow it down to one of those 3 things. You know, if something's not going well, or if something's going great, it's because I played the right role. If it's not going well, it's because I'm not playing the right role. I can get really caught up into what things are not as they seem. You know, and we have an enemy. I mean, sometimes we can, and that's the first thing when Jesus did the kingdom of heaven is like the farmer who throws a seed, and the birds come and snatch it off the path. And the birds represent Satan. We have an enemy. We always have an enemy. So big time, things are not as they seem. Things are not as they seem. Philip Yancey is another guy that I have read extensively and really like his take on things. And he's telling the story. He's telling about how he's in China. And he is—he's doing a lot of stuff with the underground church in China. And this would have been 20 years ago or so. And he's just describing, you know, what it's like. What it's like to be sneaking into places and the fear that he had to deal with, and to think that, you know, you realize that if we get caught, you know, you're just flashing your passport is not just going to magically get you back to the United States. So this was scary stuff that they were doing. And so they would sneak around, and he said, and we would go into these little places. And he said, and so these pastors would come in because they wanted to hear Philip Yancey teach and talk about the stuff in some of the books that he'd written. And he said, you know, we'd go in and we'd sneak around and we'd get in this place and it'd be seven or eight. And then we would go about our day and we'd go to a little place and do all of this stuff, kind of like the movies, you know. And get in a place and there'd be seven or eight. And he's telling the story about after a while, he was just kind of feeling like, okay, you know, there's a lot of risk going on here, and for seven or eight, you know, for seven or eight, and for seven or eight. And he said, and he tells the story of talking to a Chinese pastor. And so he's talking to him, and the pastor's asking him questions, and he's talking about some different theology things, and da-da-da-da-da-da. And the Chinese pastor keeps mentioning his church. And Philip's talking about how I'm thinking church is, you know, seven or eight people. It's seven or eight people. And he said, so finally I asked this pastor, you know, how many people would you say is in your congregation, it's in your church? How many people are you shepherding? How many people are you pastoring? And he said, 250. And Philip was like, that's more like it. 1,000. 250,000. And he's almost sitting there, it's just, things are not as they seem. And we got to remember that. And yes, it's just so many things going on, and God is always doing something. I posted this on my Facebook one time. I think it's from John Piper, who said that, you know, at any given time, God's doing about 3,000 things in your life, and you're aware of about 3 of them. And that's how God works. And so when we have our job is not to. Is not to figure out everything. Our job is to be the yeast, and it's to be as evasive as that we can be, and to stand for the truth, and to state the truth, and to live the truth. This is what we're supposed to be doing. Yes.
I just don't understand. So there's one piece of the yeast thing I don't get. We're the yeast, but if we don't take good care of the yeast dies. If you put too much heat.
Yeah, absolutely. The yeast being the kingdom of God. And if the kingdom of God is being in the here and the now. And so the kingdom of God is made up of people. Okay, and this is what the church is. The church is people. So yes, we are supposed to talk and we're supposed to take care of each other. That's going to be a part of the sermon on this coming Sunday. It's like we've talked about the last couple of weeks about my broken heart, and when I'm brokenhearted and what do I do? Well, one of our callings as people, as Christians, is to share each other's burdens. It's to help each other. So if you don't have enough yeast in your bread, then somebody needs to be coming alongside of you, helping you get that right.
So if I'm yeast, I could be doing everything right, though.
Yes.
By example, blah, blah, blah. I'm doing everything right, but nothing.
Go ahead. But I got something I want to come back to what you just said, though. No, go ahead. Well, now let me say it, because I will forget, okay? In the parable of the sower, there's seed that falls on the good, and they don't all produce the same amount.
So where the seed?
No, the seed is the gospel. The seed is the truth of Jesus, okay? But the fruit that is produced, okay? It doesn't. So I may spend my life trying to take as many people to heaven as I can. By living properly in the here and now with the right focus here. Well, and the result of my of what I do and what God's gifted me to do may be the result of a, you know, 50 people enter into heaven because of the way that I've lived. Okay? For somebody else, it may be, for that Chinese pastor, it may be 3.4 million people for him. And then for somebody else in the room, it may be one. For somebody, it may be none. Because we're not guaranteed the result. Okay? Does that make sense? All right? But the yeast is us. It's us if we are a part of the kingdom. If we're not a part of the kingdom, then we're not the yeast. Okay? That makes sense? All right, okay. All right.
I'm thinking the yeast is more of a catalyst, that we are there to help the kingdom grow, that we can, you know, consider the yeast the kingdom of heaven and we are part of it here on earth as believers, to make that bread grow, to make that bread rise, to make that kingdom expand. We have to have an influence. And Marty, each of our lives touch so many other lives. We don't even realize in the smallest way that I get very emotional about it, because I've had people call me for patients or students and medical students 30 years ago, and they say, you said one thing, and to me it was nothing.
Yes.
And to them it was like a turning point.
Yes.
And I get that it's unbelievable. When I'm flying to work every week, if somebody, I talk to everyone, so somebody sitting next to me, we start chatting, they're going for a test, they're going, I ask them, do you believe in God? I give them a prayer card, we talk. That little bit, and I'm very helpful, listen to me, I don't sound like a preacher, I don't sound like a religious person. So, well, yeah, right. But, so, and it's true, you got to come across very, well, who you are. Not a preacher, I'm not a, you know, a sacred person, but I tell them how I became a Christian and how it affects my life in a positive way. And that, just be humble like a normal, sweet person self. You know, I don't pull out a Bible and start, you know, reading.
Well, you did, though. It scared me to death.
I just say it. And you, even if you have to pray for someone, somebody I go to emergency here is having surgery tomorrow, and I said to him, you know, I don't know if you believe in this, but is it okay if I prayed with you about it? And he said, oh, I do believe it. Now, I would never have known that. But you got to take the risk. So they say no, it's no. The reason people like doing the mission, giving to, it's so anonymous. You don't have to take any, you give a little money. You can't, you have to invest it of yourself. Besides the money, it's your passion that has to come across, not just your checkbook. And that's where individually is the best way to reach people. Because they see you personally.
Yes. And which is by the way, is how Jesus set it up. That's how God set it up. He didn't set it up for a church, you know, for an institution to reach somebody. The best, you have a far better chance of impacting your family than I do. You have a far better chance of impacting your neighbor than I do. Now I have a far better chance of impacting my neighbor than you do. That none of you live on my street. So that's the way that works, okay? So it is understanding who we are, but it has to start. It has to start, am I a Christian? Am I in? Have I been redeemed? And when we get into this series on the Holy Spirit, we're going to talk about that. Several different weeks, we're going to talk about what's that mean? Do I have the Holy Spirit? When I have the Holy Spirit, He's going to help me do those kinds of things. Now, it's very important to do, like you said, that would scare me to death. Right. And so, but there are other ways to do it. There's other, we're not all, that's the thing I love. One of the things amazing about to me about God is God loves variety. And He didn't all gift us the same way. You know, it takes my dad 30 minutes to get gas. He talks to everybody. Okay. I can go all day and not talk to anybody and I'm happy. Right? So we are all made differently and we're all created differently. So a big part of this is trying to figure out, okay, how am I wired? What is it that I can do? I know people who can pray for hours. I know people who can pray for 30 seconds. Because their brain just doesn't work that way. So the person who doesn't do that, so to say, hey, what you've got to do for God's kingdom is for you to pray 3 hours a day, then that's, no. And for somebody who's a shy introvert to say you got to go talk to everybody you don't know, no, that's not how it works. So to collectively together, we're the kingdom of God and we're the yeast, and we all come together and we do what we do and what God has created us to do, and then as individuals and as a group, we can make a difference in the kingdom.
I think the other thing, the trap that we so commonly get into is we think we got to have all the answers. And the trap that I think we get into about how do we share our faith is we're fearful that we have to have all these answers. My experience is all you have to do is ask one simple question and then just listen. And often it can be as simple as, where's God in your life? Is God anywhere in your life? And just ask that question. You don't have to say anything else, because the person that you ask that question of will usually go off for the next 30 minutes about where he is or where he isn't. And yeah. All you've got to do is facilitate the listening process. You don't have to have all the answers.
Right. Spoken like a true extrovert. That you are. So you have to be careful. We have to be careful when we say all you have to do. Because sometimes the all you have to do part is what I can't get to.
Sometimes all you have to do is ask, hey, what's going on?
Andy Stanley has three things he says to look for. They look for the three knots. Not going well, not prepared for, and not in church. So when you're talking to somebody, if it's not going well, be getting ready to go for a test or a cert, so things are not going well, and they probably aren't prepared for. So if somebody's not prepared for, not going well, not in church, that's a great opportunity to step in and to ask a simple question. And sometimes the simple question just is this, hey, why don't you come to church with me? We'll go to lunch afterwards. And just let me do the talking. You know, and Brent, yeah, and my wife Lisa, and other extroverts in the room, they can do all the talking, and me and you can just sit over in the corner and let them do that. So that has worked. Any other comments or questions before we close?
We'll go. Are you going to get all churchy on me?
Yes.
And I don't like churchy people. I'm sorry.
No, I don't either. So I can't stand churchy people. I tell you, when I go play golf with somebody, if I'm on the airplane or I'm whatever, you know the question I dread the most? What do you do for a living? I hate that question. I don't lie, but I don't say very much. I will say, I just work with people. What do you mean you work with people? Well, that kind of teach. Well, what do you teach? This and that. So I'd string them along till they get in. But if I just, unless I don't like the person, then I say, well, I'm a preacher, and then conversation's over. or if I'm playing golf with someone and he's got a really foul mouth and about the third hole I've had enough of it, I start talking about Jesus. And then it's amazing how much they clear up after that. But yeah, I'm not a churchy person either. You know, I don't, Jesus wasn't churchy. None of this stuff is churchy. He's using stuff like farming and yeast and stuff like that. He's using everyday stuff. Everyday stuff. Yes. And I do have a good friend. I have a friend. I remember the time he told me, he says, Marty, I've come to the conclusion I'm going to stop telling people that Jesus loves them. And I said, Dan, you can't do that. You can't stop telling people that Jesus loves them. He says, no, I'm just going to start telling them how much he loves me. And it's like, but you got to have that relationship in order to do that. Yeah, caring for people is a huge deal. Yeah.
It's be a friend to have a friend.
That's exactly right, FG. That is, and so many people are friend poor. And so they're really looking for that.
You mentioned earlier that there are some people that you may not like because of, you know, how they impact you. Do people have that?
No, we will not. We will not. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago, that all relationships are, in fact, and if in a week or two we'll get to, like, Scott McKnight does a great job of talking about the first, what's the first hour in heaven like? And he talks about that. He talks about the first hour in heaven, everything will be reconciled. We're recording this, so I'm not saying anything. I will just say when we get to heaven, we'll be surprised by who's there. And we probably will be surprised by who's not there. That's all I'm going to say about that one. All right. Yeah, we got to go, especially if you got kids next door, so let me pray. Father God, we thank you for tonight, and thank you for your written word so that we can read it and for giving us minds to be able to process and think through it. Father, I pray that you would meet each one of us exactly where we are in our relationship with you. And for those of us who have been walking with you for a very, very long time, may you continue to help us to be more like you. For those of us who are just beginning that journey, may we not get frustrated, but may we understand that you're right there with us and you're going to be with us every step of the way. And Father, for there's any of us that are in the room, any of us that are watching this that don't have that relationship with you, Father, may you do everything that you can to get their attention, to surrender their life to you, so that not only can they experience heaven in the future, but they can experience heaven in the here and the now. In your name we pray. Amen.